Just off Canada's west coast, beyond the intricate coastlines, are sublime underwater forests full of giant seaweeds and extraordinary biodiversity. These kelp forests are some of the most productive habitats on Earth, a haven for creatures to hide from prey and compete for food. It's here, amid the fronds of kelp, that so much of the marine life we know is first born into the sea. These kelp forests protect shorelines, are hugely important to First Nations, and of high economic value. But with sea temperatures rising, these vulnerable forests are in danger of being lost. To get the big picture, researchers are diving deep and taking to the skies to see what the bare earth landscape will reveal. But will it be enough to help save our kelp forests? Here in this kelp forest, there are creatures hiding out and making a home just about everywhere. From the base of the kelp, where the foot or holdfast wraps around the rocks, rooting the kelp into place, to the fronds high above, kelp forests reach up into the water column, adding complex 3D structure. And disturbances to kelp forests can cause ripple effects throughout an ecosystem. Luba Reshitnik and her Hakai colleagues are working closely with university, federal, provincial, and First Nations research partners to fill in the picture on what's happening to these kelp forests over time. But before she can look at the whole coast, Luba needs to start by learning everything she can about a single bed of kelp. And the best way to map kelp is from the air. She flies a drone in a grid-like pattern over a football field-sized patch of kelp, creating a giant mosaic of photos. From the sky, she can calculate the total area this kelp bed extends.
Seeing big changes in kelp beds can be a potential indicator that things are changing in our coastal oceans.
Satellites have been taking aerial images of the Earth every 16 days since 1984. So a part of Luba's work is to compare the aerial mosaics she takes to these images dating back decades to see how the kelp beds are faring.
Kelp only like to grow typically below 17 or 18 degrees. So warming waters would really impact not only how well they grow, but how well they're able to reproduce.
This became especially apparent in 2015, when a mass of warm water known as the Blob began stretching from southeastern Alaska down to Mexico. The kelp forests struggled to grow in these hotter waters. And on top of that, urchin populations are already putting a lot of stress on kelp forests. Urchins are voracious grazers that can literally mow down a once luscious bed of kelp for breakfast. Luckily, there are a few urchin predators out there that can help to keep the urchin populations in check, like these sea otters, or these funny-looking sea stars called pycnopodia that love eating tiny urchins. But when these predators aren't around, like when 19th century fur traders took sea otters to the verge of extinction, or when sea star wasting disease devastated pycnopodia numbers, the urchins are left to thrive, and kelp, in turn, suffers. Luba hopes to better understand these drivers of change and where we find resilient beds in order to protect these important marine habitats.
What we can do specifically at this site is really limited. You know, the drone can only fly so high and so far away from us, but we really don't want to necessarily limit ourselves to understanding just what's happening at the site.
To get that bigger picture, Luba hopes to deploy the Airborne Coastal Observatory, or ACO, a plane equipped with high-end cameras to capture tens and hundreds of square kilometers worth of imagery.
And what's really cool with the ACO is that we now have what we can think about as a sort of a really souped-up drone on a plane.
The trouble with mapping here on the central coast of BC is that it requires optimal flying conditions. But here, rain and clouds reign supreme.
Hey, Steve.
How's it going?
Pretty good.
Pilot Robin Stewart and geospatial technician Steve Beffert are a key piece of the aerial team and have logged hundreds of hours in the plane mapping all over the coast. They want to map the kelp at the lowest tide possible, when the most kelp will be visible on the surface, which doesn't leave them with many options.
For Monday, and it looks like a bit of a mixed bag.
The north coast starts around where we want to work. So yeah. As you said, no bueno, Monday looks kind of out.
Day one is a bust, but while it's too cloudy above the water, it's still a great day for exploring kelp underwater. That's where the divers come in. The divers swim along these transect tapes, stopping to count all the kelps. While the aerial images give us an idea of how far the kelp forests extend, we want to know how many kelp plants are actually in these forests and how much kelp mass there is under the water. In order to match up their precise findings with the aerial images above, every 5 minutes they release a buoy. On the surface, Lupa takes a picture using a drone of the buoy's location, creating a GPS reference of the underwater transects. Then, at the end of the dive, they pull up some plants to measure the length and compare that to previous year's measurements. The divers calculate the total amount of kelp at every monitoring site and are working with Luba to figure out if what they measure underwater is related to how much kelp is seen from the surface. But remember, Luba doesn't just want to measure this one kelp bed. She wants to use this information to find out how much kelp there is along the whole coast. For that, we'll need more than drones. So Steve and Robin are going to have to get that plane running.
I think we're gonna have to get up in the morning and see.
Fortunately, day two brings some luck.
Between expertise and luck, I think we've timed it pretty well here. Okay, so today's mission is kelp mapping. We're flying right now at about 1,000 meters above sea level, and that will give us a really good resolution for the images that we're collecting.
The plane follows the same grid pattern as the drones, but on a much larger scale.
Each red or blue cross piece you see as I cross and X appears is a photo being taken by one of Steve's cameras.
The cameras on board detect not only colors, but also near-infrared imagery, light just outside of what's visible to the human eye. And it's that near-infrared imagery that really helps Luba and her team more easily tell apart the kelp from the water. Once Luba receives all the images from these flights, it's a matter of sewing them all together in a giant mosaic. Then the real work comes in, identifying the kelp in the imagery. But Luba doesn't just do this by hand. She's been working alongside a Hakai computer scientist to develop a tool called the Kelpomatic, which uses machine learning to automate the classification of kelp in the high-resolution imagery. What used to take days or even weeks, she can now do in just a few minutes or hours. Then, with the new kelp mosaics in hand, they are working to take what they've learned about the mass and density of a few kelp forests and extrapolate to the whole coast in partnership with the many indigenous stewardship groups and researchers doing kelp monitoring along our coast. On our changing planet, kelp faces an uphill battle. But this year's kelp mosaic shows a small rebound from the previous year. Something to be optimistic about. The Kelpomatic tool is not only tracking kelp forests here in British Columbia, but is open source software that is already being used by researchers from California to Alaska, a true turning of the tides for kelp mapping. Kelp forests are too important to our sea life, economies, shorelines, and to the health of our planet to be forgotten. What would our oceans look like without kelp forests? We don't ever want to know.